Why the hell have I come to this planet? Has any one of you ever asked any question to yourself? Raise your hands. Very good. How many of you are those who raise their hands? Found an answer to this question? Very few. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am Brigadier Sushil Bhasin, 34 years in the army and 15 years now in the education and corporate domain. I found this answer to this question when I was 51 years young. In 2002, I found an answer to this question, why the hell am I here on this planet? But before I tell you what happened, let me tell you two stages of my awakening before I got that answer. In 2015, I attended a workshop on money and you, and Mrs. Dame Cordova taught me something which I want to share with you. What do you think this is?
Cloth.
Wow. That means I can draw quite well, because normally people do not understand that this is a flower. Good that you recognize my drawing. Who did that, Vasay, by the way?
Yes.
Who said flower? So my prizes come flying. Sorry. Right. So you take it. Right. Now what I'm going to draw, let me see if you can recognize this, because this is not what people generally recognize. What is this? What is this? Who said honeybee? Who said honeybee somewhere? Somebody said honeybee, okay? Oh, sorry. Okay. So, this honeybee gets attracted to the flower, goes and sucks nectar, and it is on its hairy body, it gets some pollen. It goes to another flower, drops some pollen, and collect some pollen. What is it called?
Pollination.
Pollination. Oh, you've got a brilliant audience here. Pollination. How many of you think these bees get up in the morning, have their breakfast and say, come on, let's go for cross-pollination? Does this bee know that it came to this planet for this purpose?
No.
And if these bees were like you and me, we would have said, what the hell am I doing this hard work for day by day when nobody even thanks me for it? What an ungrateful world. Have you ever thanked the bees for what they do for you? And supposing they also behave like what we do in Delhi particularly, let's go on a strike. Nobody recognizes us. Nobody gives us our due. So if these bees went on a strike, what would happen? No flowers, no nature, no honey, right? Now, after a few years, I went on another workshop called Train the Trainer, and Blair Singer, one of the very top trainers, he amplified this further and added something to the bee story. And he said, what does a man do? And when I say man, I also mean a woman. What do they do? They go every day for work. The bee did it for honey. The man goes to work for
money.
What is the cumulative effect? The cumulative effect of the bees going and sucking nectar and getting that pollen was honey, and was also keeping the nature intact. What is the cumulative effect of the people getting money?
Giving value.
When we get money, what do we do with it?
We spend it.
We spend it on what?
On ourselves, others, our clothes,
clothes. We buy a lot of things to increase our standard of living, is that right?
Yes.
We earn more money to get a better gadget, to upgrade ourselves and things like that.
Yes.
So the cumulative effect of all this is that the standard of living starts to rise. right? How many of you will agree with me that the standard of living of an average man today is far better than the standard of living of the richest man 50 years ago? Yes?
Yes.
So, when I got into the car, coming back home that evening, a thought came to my mind. And I said, in this world, I am enjoying so many things because millions of people have worked very hard to give us what we have. Edison gave us electricity. He didn't say, deposit money in my account, when you use it, I've patented it. Wright Brothers gave us a plane. Do we fly the same plane that Wright Brothers gave us? No. Millions of people have gone around improving the plane, improving the car, everything. Today I have a mobile phone in my pocket. I have Ola coming to my house. I have food coming to my house. I can do net banking, AI and robotics and what all. How many people have done this for me? Then what did I come to this world for? Did I come to this world to go to school, get educated, go to college, get a degree, and then every day of my life, go to work in the morning, come back in the evening. Go in the morning, come back in the evening. And at the end of the month, draw a salary check and pay bills. Have I come to this planet to pay bills?
No.
That is the question that came to me. And it's everyone here in this planet came for a purpose. What is that purpose? So if you do what the bee does, you do what you ought to do. What you ought to do? What your parents told you, what your family told you, what your religion told you, your community told you, your country's laws. If you just keep doing what you ought to do, you may be achieving the purpose of your life even without knowing it. In 2002, I was posted from Ambala to Bareilly. And I was told, you'll be the chairman of the army school. School? I didn't even go to college. I'm an uneducated guy. I went straight from Senex school, 10th class pass, to NDA. And I'm going to be the chairman of the army school. And then I'm told the school is in a bad shape. It's in a mess. And somebody tells me in Ambala, sir, you are going to be in deep shit. I said, why? Sir, the school is going to keep you occupied. I reached Bareilly and my boss, the general officer commanding, in my first interview says, Sushil, I know you'll do very well in your professional work, but I have a challenge for you. I have an additional task for you. You will be the chairman of the army school. And that school, I'm afraid, is in a mess. I just say, everyone is telling me this, but why? He said, last 2 years, we've had no continuous principal there. And the teachers, and he said, pardon my language, and I'm also asking you to pardon my language. He says, you know, they are mostly army officers' wives and they do more of bitching than teaching. And then he says, there's a head clerk there. For the last 17 years that the school has been in existence, he's been there. So he's willy-nilly become the power center and the authority in the school. I want you to bring some direction in the school. I got into my car to come back home. My daughter at that point of time was in college. My son was in class 12, and for me at that point of time, my children's career was more important to me than my own career. And I said, isn't it the same for the parents of these 2,000 children? Aren't they also looking at the career of these children? How can I allow the 2,000 children's career to be neglected? I reached home, I told my wife, I don't know what happens in my office, I'll manage that. I've got 5 officers. I'll have delegation, empowerment, all those leadership qualities I'll apply there. And I may work at night, but I'll spend time in school. So ladies and gentlemen, I got down to it with my whole heart and said, I'm going to make sure that these 2,000 children become good human beings. And for that, I'm prepared to pay any price. So I improved the infrastructure. I did everything what a common sense could tell me because I was not an educator. 6 months down the line, the school was totally changed. We had a summer vacation. People came back after summer vacation and couldn't recognize that school. One day at an event, the head girl came on the stage and she said, "Sir, I want to say a few words to the chairman." And for 10 minutes she continued saying all good that had happened in the school. And then she said something which touched the core of my heart. She said, "Sir, thank you for restoring our pride. When we were playing in the colony, other children used to tease us and say, 'You go to the army school?' And we used to hang our head in shame because there's nothing to be proud of. Sir, now when they say, 'You go to the army school,' we say, 'Yes.'" And then she said this, "Yes." 800 children stood up and clapped. And that was a moment of triumph for me. That was a moment I could feel success. And while I was enjoying that moment of success, she said, "Sir, can you please come on the stage and accept a small token of our love for you?" And what she gave me was a 12 feet long scroll in the shape of a pencil. I'm just trying to depict this with a small little drawing as to what this pencil looked like. Every class took an A4 size paper, 9A, 9B, 9C, 9D, 10th A, 10B. They made a scroll like this. On top, they made an eraser and said, "No organization ever changed without a good leader. Sir, thank you for your leadership." At the bottom, they made this lead. And on that lead, they said, "Sir, we love you. We'll never forget you." For me, it was my Param Vishisht Seva Medal. The army didn't give it to me. I got into the car, the flag was fluttering, there was a star plate there. And as the car was driving, anyone on the road was saluting me. And I said to myself, "Don't get too excited. They are saluting the flag and the star, not you. You put a donkey here, they will salute that donkey as well. And tomorrow when you are out of this car and you don't have that star, nobody is going to salute you." And then I had a conversation with God. And I said, "God, thank you very much for everything you have given me. I can't ask you for anything more. You have given me power, authority, money. You have given me a wonderful wife. You have given me 2 lovely children. You have given me good health. What else can I ask you for? Materially, I've got a car, I've got a house, I've got a fridge, I've got a computer. I can ask you for upgradations. I can say, 2 bedroom ka ghar nahi chalega. Abhi mere ko bungalow chahiye. This 19 inch or 29 inches TV is not good enough. I want a home theater. But what new can I ask you? God, I think my life is meant for these children." I that day discovered the purpose of my life, that the rest of my life I'm going to live for these children. I went back home, showed the scroll to my wife. And then I told her, after a little silence, "Benny, I'm going to lead the army." She said, "Are you mad?" I don't know how many of you have any idea what army and the army officers' wives. They want to be generals' wives more than the officer wants to be a general. So I told her, I said, "If you still want to be a general's wife, start looking out for somebody. I'm going out as a general." Anyway, that was just a joke, but my wife and my children were so supportive. I had a general's rank coming up. I was very young in age, highly qualified, and nothing could have stopped me from becoming a general. But children became more important. In 2004, I left the army and started doing my work for children. Today, in the last 15 years, I have touched the life of 25,000 children, about 3,000 teachers, about 160 principals, maybe about 4,000 to 5,000 parents. And then of course, there was time when there were no children available, exams and all that, started corporate training. I am living a life with the motto, the rest of my life is the best of my life. Wow. I am doing work to make sure that I did not come, I will not go and tell God that I was here all the time to receive. I told you, everyone is giving us so much, everything is happening. And the question was, did I come to this world only to keep receiving? What will I give back? When I get a gift, I feel like giving back, isn't it? When I get so much from life, what am I going to give back before I go? And that is the purpose with which I am living. So I wrote a book called Design Your Life. And Design Your Life was written with this purpose in mind, that every child should, and it's all full of stories, no theories. I say, look at how you are going to live your life. Decide your path yourself, don't depend on others. And to parents, a lot of parents here, your child did not come to this world for your purpose. He came for his purpose. Please support him in his purpose and don't make him a doctor because you wanted to be a doctor and couldn't become. Who wants this book? Who wants this book? Who really wants this book? Yeah, because a lot of people really want this book. This book is out for sale. I'll see how many people buy it. But free mein sabko chahiye. Free mein bhi milti hai. But not by sitting in your chair. You sit in your comfort zone and keep saying, success, come here, success doesn't come. You run and get to the success. Okay. So, anyway, nobody gets this book because nobody came to me. Okay, here he comes and he gets it.
Thank you.
Here, my idea was, come. No. Okay. Idea was to end up my talk by saying, opportunities will come, grab them. Don't keep sitting in your chair and say, I want to do it, I want. In the break, somebody told me, I want to do great things in my life. And I said, come out of your comfort zone. In this book, there's one chapter on comfort zone and I have called it the DK zone. You will DK in your comfort zone, come out. No success was ever found in the comfort zone. So I certainly hope that you will look for finding your purpose of life and live a life full of fulfillment, purpose and meaning. Thank you.